Dr. Amanda with Straightsmile Solutions, straightsmilesolutions.com, and the topic today is why I like expanding lower arches in mixed dentition cases together with the upper arches to coordinate arch forms, to widen the nice arches, and to prevent impacted lower canines and scissor bites from developing. Phew, that's a lot, right? And I have a few other videos about lower expansion in mixed dentition. And notice I am saying, well, this even could translate into comprehensive care. And I'll explain this a little bit more. But basically, in a nutshell, the reason why I do it, especially in mixed dentition, is that what is the reason that we have crowding in the first place? Well, the first reason we have crowding in the first place is because arches are underdeveloped due to their tongue tie, habits, tongue position, or just general soft diet and misuse of facial muscles as an infant, and underdeveloped muscles as a toddler, an infant, and young child because of diet. So basically damage is done because we're not doing things correctly, and then the jaws don't grow out to the normal width. So crowding, like I've gone through my other lectures on crowding, that's a first world problem. It's not something that's happened historically in tribal cultures. There are anthropological data that backs this up. And if you'd like to hear or see some of those papers, I'll gladly refer some to you. There's also some great books on the topic. Anyways, the damage happens, and the great thing is that we want to try to catch it while the patient is young, 7, 8, 9, 10, so that we can intervene. And by intervening and growing the arches to the right size, the right width, the right position relative to their cranial base, then often the teeth come in straight to begin with, you know, the mixed dentition teeth. Yes, we have to straighten the front teeth and fix the bites, but if we do that, often things stay straight, which is really, really awesome. And the new teeth, that new set, your threes, the fours, the fives, the canines, and the bicuspids and the second molars come in nice and straight often. So that's the benefit of doing it. Sure, you can just do, and I do understand that a maxilla is a two-shelf piece, and I do understand that you really can't split a suture on the lower arch. Yes, of course, I understand. I took basic anatomy, but you can still widen it. And yes, if you do widen the top palate, often the lower teeth, as long as they're not trapped in a plant, will roll out and meet it over time. This will often happen. However, it's very, very slow. And then it can limit how much you can turn the top arch. And that's the reason why I like to do the lower arch and mixed dentition at the same time. Otherwise, you're limited as to how much you can do the top arch, and you can't necessarily do it to the full width. A lot of doctors end up stopping because they're afraid they're going to get a scissor bite or a Brody bite or a Bruckle cross bite. And so they don't get to the top to the right width. They stop short, and they still end up with impacted canines, and they're short on space. So that is why I do the lower simultaneously, unless it's clear that there's plenty of space in the lower arch. There's no crowding, zero crowding at all. And the only issue is on the top, then I'll do top only. But if I see any crowding happening, and I'm going to use the pano, I'm going to use doing the occlusogram or just visualize the space that I have in the pano and also in clinically, so I know if my arch is constrictive. If it's something super minor, usually it will roll out, you know, 1 or 2 millimeters. But I'm talking where you see evidence of actual crowding in mixed dentition. That's not right. You should never, ever have any crowding in any arches. Permanent teeth should have 6 millimeters between the teeth. That's what's normal on the lower. You should see spacing. If you do not see 6 millimeters of spacing, you have crowding in mixed dentition. So that's why, and that's what I do. And I'll even do it in adult teeth, even in permanent teeth. Sometimes, especially if there's a case where there's a lot of crowding and I'm taking a look at the SAF or the profile and I see a full profile, I see flared incisors, I don't want them to come forward. I know if I just throw braces on or let things unravel, everything's going to come forward. So the nice thing about doing a lower expander, even in permanent dentition on a teen, is that you can create the space transversely before you create the space in an AP or proclination direction, which maybe is contraindicated. Now, of course, if they're going to Invisalign, there's really no reason because it does the exact same thing. But if you're trying to take a case and you're deciding whether it's extraction, non-extraction, and you want to slowly create some space without flaring incisors or worry about pushing them through the buccal plate, that's the nice thing about lower expanders in permanent dentition as well. Nice and slow. And I do personally, I have done both rapid and slow expansion. I tend to do more slow expansion in my consulting business just because, and that's how I tend to teach my doctors, because it's so much more dangerous to do it rapid in terms of side effects and things that can happen, pushing teeth to the plate, losing track of the patient. And also discomfort tends to happen a lot less. You don't see that really ugly space that develops between the front two teeth. So that's why I like to do slow expansion. But I understand many of you have been trained on fast expansion. That's something you're trained to do. It just doesn't work well on the lower to do fast, okay? So it's a different type of anatomy. So that's another reason. If it's an upper only, then maybe if you're trained on fast, so be it. You understand what the risks are. I can tell you scary stories about things that have happened with fast dentition, and it might change your mind. So, all right, thanks so much.